Hey everyone! Welcome back to another episode of Shoup Tech. In the last video, we took a look at Storm Linux 2000, which was the very first Linux distribution I ever used. Well, today we're going to take a look at the second distro I used, and that was Corel Linux. I remember Corel Linux being easier to use than Storm Linux, and I remember in high school I was able to complete more basic tasks that a kid in high school like me would need to do. I wasn't a programmer or anything, but I did take classes that I needed to write papers for or look things up on the internet. Was the internet a thing in the year 2000? I think so. But before we go exploring into it, let's discuss a little bit of Corel Linux's background. In 1999, Corel bet big on Linux. Over the next year or so, Corel would not only release its own distribution of Linux, it would also release an office suite and the Corel Draw graphics suite on Linux. While many distributions at the time took an approach of shoving as many packages as they could into a distribution, Corel took a simpler approach, choosing quality over quantity. According to Maximum Linux's review of Corel Linux, this was an attempt to ease the Linux culture shock. That same review has the quote, "It's the first Linux distribution to offer a viable alternative to the average Windows user." Corel Linux was offered in three flavors. The free or open circulation edition, this one could be downloaded from their website and could be found with many magazines. There was also a standard edition that cost $59. The standard edition came with a 350 plus page user guide, 30 days of email support, more fonts, and some extra software such as WordPerfect 8. Finally, if you had the money, there was a deluxe edition at $89. The deluxe edition came with everything the standard edition did, and threw in telephone support, even more fonts, and even more software, such as OSS sound drivers and Civilization Call to Power. The deluxe edition even came with a Tux mascot toy. Unfortunately, Corel Linux did not last long. Its first release, according to Wikipedia, was in November of 1999, with its second and last release in August of 2000. After that, Corel Linux saw no further updates. Eventually, the property was acquired by Zandros, who would then go on to create a new distribution based off of it. In a period of just a couple years, Corel went from having its own distribution and a large suite of applications that ran on Linux to nearly completely abandoning the platform. Let's see just how easy and amazing Corel Linux was to you, beginning with installing it. For today's adventure, I'm going back to my Premio 2 PC. I'm using the Corel Linux Open Circulation CD-ROM. During our adventures with Storm Linux, I was using a 32GB SD card. Today, I decided to use a 30GB IDE hard drive instead to increase the retro authenticity. The first step is to boot from the CD-ROM. There are instructions in a text file on the CD for how to create a bootable floppy in both Windows and Linux if you needed to. After a couple minutes, the installer loads and prompts you to accept the license agreement. The installer then prompts for a username. The next screen is for package selection. The first choice is either standard or custom. Going into custom gives you the choice of desktop, desktop plus, server, or custom. If you dig into custom, you can choose packages individually or just select all of them. I went with all of them because I can. After package selection is disk partitioning. The options here are straightforward. You can have Corel Linux erase everything, use free space, or edit the partition table yourself. There's even an intriguing option to allow you to install Corel Linux inside an existing DOS file system. For this video, I chose to erase the whole thing. The last screen summarizes your choices and gives you a chance to perform a bad block scan while formatting. After a click of install, it's off to the races. About 20 minutes later, the installer prompts you to restart the system. That's it! Corel Linux is installed. Just a simple 4 screens. In my opinion, that makes it one of the easiest to install Linux distributions ever. To this day, you'd be hard-pressed to find an installer that's easier to use than this one. To be fair, you do sacrifice some ability for customization, but frankly, most users don't need that level of customization. I'd go so as far to say this was easier to install than Windows. When the system reboots, you hit what is really my first complaint. The loading screen doesn't give any indication that it's even doing anything. There's a disk-looking image in the bottom right that spins for a few seconds, but after that, the screen appears frozen for a little over a minute. The only indication that anything is happening is the hard disk activity. I think it would have been nice to display the boot messages in a way that was similar to how Storm Linux handled it. My guess is Corel went for a simple boot screen with no messages, as that would have been more familiar to Windows users, but at least Windows users got a moving bar at the bottom of the screen. Now that we've booted, let's go exploring! Corel Linux first prompts you to log in as root. There are no passwords for either root or the user created during install, so I was happy to see Corel Linux prompted you to change the password. First, let's look at the Corel Control Center. This application has a very intuitive and easy-to-use interface for managing the system. It looks almost identical to the stock KDE Control Center from the era, but has more settings in it, such as the ability to configure the video settings. That's great, because for whatever reason, it defaulted to 43Hz at 1024x768. I bumped up the refresh rate to 70Hz. That seems kind of odd, but the VGA capture device I'm using seems to work better at that rate than either 60Hz or 75Hz. After applying the settings, I was told to hit Ctrl-Alt-Backspace. For the uninitiated, that's the three-finger salute for killing your ex-server. After a few seconds, KDM kicks back in and restarts X at the chosen refresh rate and resolution. With video working great, it was time to move on to sound. Like Storm Linux, my Sound Blaster Live did not work out of the box, but fortunately, the install CD has instructions for dealing with it. Using the wonderful Corel Update utility, I first made sure the CD-ROM was available as a source and deselected Corel's repository source. Unfortunately, Corel's FTP servers no longer have packages for Corel Linux. Running the Update Profile button does the same thing as apt-get update, and then I was able to find a package for EMU10K1, which is the module needed for my sound card. Installation through the utility worked, though for some reason it did say an error occurred when it was finished. After a little bit of messing around, I decided to try a reboot. After the reboot completed, I had sound! Thank you, Corel, for including the drivers for the Sound Blaster Live on your CD, and even including instructions in a README file. It's the little things like that which made Corel Linux awesome. With sound working, I logged in as the non-super user. Much like logging in as root, there is no password and you are prompted to change it. On the subject of sound, do you remember the music player that really whips the llama's ass? I sure do. Winamp never had a Linux version, but Linux had the second best music player to it, XMMS. This came pre-installed on Corel Linux and was an awesome piece of software to include. One of the neatest features of Corel Linux was its file manager. This was a modified version of the default KDE file manager with quite a few features that weren't standard on KDE at the time. For example, Corel Linux would auto-mount external devices, and the Corel file manager had these listed. If you were coming from Windows, not having to think about how to mount a disk was very beneficial. The Corel file manager also supported connecting to NFS shares, or even Windows file shares. Of course, the network this computer is on has no networked file shares available to it. Much like other file managers, double-clicking a file in it automatically opens the file in a predetermined application. This MP3, for example, will open in XMMS. The rest of the environment is fairly stock KDE. The K-panel configuration and virtual desktops looked similar to other KDM variants of the era. The last thing to do was to find a word processor. This was an arduous process on Storm Linux, and I suspected it would still be one on Corel. For one thing, if you did not pay for Corel Linux, you did not get one of Corel's most popular software products, WordPerfect. Instead, you got, well, nothing but a text editor. I moved on over to the Corel Update utility to try and find a word processing package. Unfortunately, one of the best of the era, AbbeyWord, was not available. I had to go to the archive repositories for Debian Slink before I found one called Pathetic Writer. Installation of it was a pure breeze with Corel Update, except for this odd error message again after installation. Pathetic Writer, on the other hand, was frankly, well, pathetic. I'm not sure what graphical toolkit it uses, but I had to hold the mouse button down on the menus to be able to go through them. It didn't seem to mesh very well at all with the KDE interface. Furthermore, using it was difficult, and its default behavior for larger font sizes was incredibly silly, running the lines into each other. This really is just not an easy-to-use word processor. After exploring Corel Linux again, I can see why reviews for it were so positive. It really was just an easy experience that was very Windows-like, as long as you had hardware that it worked on. It is really a shame that this distribution didn't last much longer than a year. But Corel clearly had decided to take its business priorities elsewhere. As always, thank you for watching, and I hope you enjoyed this exploration of Corel Linux. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up, and if you'd like to see more retro Linux explorations, please hit that subscribe button. Lastly, please leave a comment with any suggestions you have or what you would like to see in future videos. Next time, I plan to take a look at Corel's attempt to bring a full Office suite to Linux. That is Corel WordPerfect Office 2000.